Japanese 5700 series have been a tremendous success for the company, with gamers buying them in droves, AIB partners offering dozens of models, and reviewers, including myself, giving the 5700's overall glowing reviews. It was only a matter of time until AMD released other 7nm GPUs, this time for the lower-end market, and the 5500 XT is finally here. The regular 5500 non-XT has already been out in the wild for some time, but that one is reserved for OEMs. The XT variant is for enthusiasts looking for a 1080p GPU, with lots of options on the market already for 1080p. Does the 5500 XT bring anything new to the table? Can it be Nvidia's recently launched 1650 Super? Or is it time we leave 1080p behind in 2019 as we move into 2020? We'll get to the 5500 XT gaming benchmarks in a second, but first let's look at the GPU specs. And there's one in particular that drove me to actually want to review it. The 5500 XT's major competitor in the 1080p segment is not really the 1650 Super or any other GPU from Nvidia, but actually the RX 580. The 580 launched in April of 2017, itself a refresh of the RX 480 launched the year earlier, and it originally retailed for $229. Nowadays, you can find an RX 580 for around $165. The thing that I find interesting about the 5500 XT, and the main reason I wanted to take a look at it, is the die size. The RX 580 has a die size of 232mm² on 14nm, while the 5500 XT has a die size of 158mm² on 7nm. For reference, the Zen 2 core chiplet is 74 to 80mm², while the Zen 2 I/O chiplet is 125mm². So interestingly, the RX 5500 is not much larger than the I/O die in Zen 2. So you can imagine where I'm going with this. I've long said that APUs will be very disruptive once we get really good 1080p performance out of them, and with 5nm looming, the RX 5500 XT is a good indicator of what we can expect to see in APUs in the not-too-distant future. The 5500 XT is available in two variants, the only difference between them being the amount of VRAM, one at 4GB and one at 8GB. This comes in the form of 12Gbps GDDR6 memory, and the memory bus is 128-bit instead of the 256-bit on the 5700 series and on the RX 580. 8GB on a 128-bit bus is interesting. AMD says the 4GB variant is fine for 1080p gaming, but for gamers who really want to push those graphics settings to the max, the 8GB variant is the way to go. The 5700 XT on Navi 10 has 40 compute units, while the 5500 XT on Navi 14 has 22 compute units, so just over half. Interestingly, the 5500 XT has a game clock of 1717MHz, which is actually higher than the regular 5700 at 1625. That gives you an idea of how gimped the 5700 really is. After much speculation regarding pricing, AMD has decided to launch the 5500 XT 4GB variant at $169 and the 8GB variant at $199. That's the suggested MSRP, but it's up to board partners to decide what to price them at, as there is no reference design for the 5500 XT. It competes directly against the 1650 Super then, which retails for around $160, depending on the model. I'll discuss pricing in more detail in the video conclusion. The total board power rating on the 5500 XT is 130 watts, versus the 100 watts of the competing 1650 Super, which, by the way, is on 12nm, not on 7nm like AMD's 5000 series. The 5500 XT requires an 8-pin connector to operate, while the 1650 Super only requires a 6-pin. Of the models available at launch, I really like this one from PowerColor, the Red Dragon variant. From what I understand, there won't be a Red Devil variant, which is usually PowerColor's more premium offering. This and the XFX models have that clean design that I personally prefer, while some of the other models went with a more traditional gamer look. And by the way, a big thank you to PowerColor for sending me the Red Dragon for review. I'll have a link in the description which you can use to order one if you wish. There's not much to mention about the design of the GPU. This model has a dual axial fan cooler. The cooler shroud is made of matte plastic with these lovely reflective rings around the fans. I love these clean industrial designs, so I definitely approve. There is at least one model with three fans, and that's one from Gigabyte. Three fans seems like an odd choice for such a tiny GPU, and we'll look at temperatures in a second. One other thing to note is that this PowerColor model does come with a DVI connector, just like the 1650 Super, while most models will come only with one HDMI and three DisplayPort connectors. This is a good move from PowerColor, as gamers in this segment often have older, cheaper monitors that only have a DVI connector, so there's no need for an adapter. And it's nice to see that it also comes with a metal backplate, which is a nice touch for a GPU in this price range. For the following gaming benchmarks, my test rig consists of the 3900X with 16 gigs of G-Skill at 3600 MHz CL16 RAM on the MSI X570 Godlike with the latest available BIOS. I'll be comparing the 5500 XT against the Zotac 1650 Super on the Nvidia side and the Sapphire Nitro RX 580 on the AMD side. I also threw in the RX 5700 non-XT to give us an idea of the performance increase if you decide to spend a bit more. Starting with Gears 5 at 1080p, the 5500 XT gets off to a good start, getting 81.5 FPS average versus 70.3 on the 1650 Super, making it 16% faster than the Nvidia counterpart. Note, however, that the RX 580 is almost tied with the 5500 XT at 78.6 FPS average. This is a trend that we will see repeated in the next few charts. At 1440p, the 5500 XT averages 55.1 FPS, while the 1650 Super gets 47.5. The 5500 XT maintains its lead of 16% versus the 1650 Super in this resolution. Bear in mind that the 1650 Super only has 4GB of VRAM versus 8GB on the other GPUs tested here. Next up is Forza Horizon 4. At 1080p, the 5500 XT got 123.7 FPS average, completely smashing the 1650 Super in this title that typically favors AMD GPUs. The 1650 Super lags behind all the GPUs tested at 87.3 FPS average, which means the 5500 XT is a massive 42% faster than the 1650 Super in this title. Jumping to 1440p, again at high settings, the 5500 XT got 98.2 FPS average, while the 1650 Super got 80.4 FPS average, which means the 5500 XT is 22% faster in this resolution. Now, Forza Horizon is obviously an outlier, but it is a game developed by Microsoft, and I suspect we will be seeing more games in the future that favor AMD's RDNA architecture versus Turing. So perhaps this game is a sign of good things coming to AMD next year. I'll point out again, however, that the RX 580 is not too far behind the 5500 XT in this title, even at 1440p. Next we have Fortnite at 1080p with the Epic quality preset. The 5500 XT got 103.6 FPS average, while the 1650 Super got 78.6 FPS average, which means the 5500 XT is 32% faster than the 1650 Super in the most popular game on the planet. There is some variance in testing this game, so it's possible that overall the difference isn't this large. If you are looking to build a PC to play Fortnite exclusively, the 5500 XT certainly seems to be the better choice in this game. At 1440p, the 5500 XT managed 64.7 FPS average, while the 1650 Super only got 48 FPS average. The lack of VRAM possibly limiting the GPU here. This means the 5500 XT is a massive 34% faster than the 1650 Super. Moving on to another very popular game, PUBG. At 1080p, the 5500 XT got 92 FPS average, while the 1650 Super got 115.1 FPS average, making the AMD GPU 20% slower than the NVIDIA equivalent in this game. Note again that there's barely any difference between the 5500 XT and the RX 580, and yes, I'll keep reminding you of that. At 1440p, the 1650 Super leads again with 71.1 FPS average versus 63.6 FPS average on the 5500 XT, which still provides a perfectly playable experience at this higher resolution with the settings set to high. Still, it's 11% slower than the 1650 Super. In Destiny 2, which has steadily gained in popularity in recent months, at 1080p the 1650 Super got 96.9 FPS average, with the 5500 XT being virtually tied at 95.6 FPS average. So it's 1% slower than the NVIDIA GPU, but you wouldn't really be able to tell them apart. And it's a similar story at 1440p with the 5500 XT at 62 FPS average and the 1650 Super at 61.1, which means that technically the 5500 XT is 1% faster. But really, that's margin of error, so the GPUs run exactly the same in this title, both at 1080p and 1440p, providing a great experience in both resolutions. Moving to another popular game, Apex Legends, at 1080p the 1650 Super got an impressive 112.9 FPS average, while the RX 5500 lagged a bit behind with 97.8 FPS average, which means it's 13% slower than the NVIDIA GPU. Just like with Fortnite, there's quite a bit of variance here, so don't read too much into this gap. At 1440p, the 5500 XT catches up thanks to its higher onboard VRAM buffer, with the GPUs tied at 79.1 FPS average for the 1650 Super and 78 for the 5500 XT, which means it's technically 1% slower, but really, it's effectively tied. Red Dead Redemption 2 is up next, and this game is a bit hard to evaluate. I used the Vulkan API and set a quality preset bar 10 notches into a balanced quality and performance setting. At 1080p, the 1650 Super was a bit faster at 51.3 FPS, while the 5500 XT got 46.6 FPS average. You'll notice that the 1% lows on the 1650 Super go all the way down to 11.2 FPS average. But that's because there's this point in the in-game benchmark where there's a strange stutter, and that gets reflected in these lows. It only happens once in the benchmark, so I wouldn't read too much into the lows here. Overall, at 1080p, the 5500 XT is 9% slower than the 1650 Super. At 1440p, in this rather demanding game, the 1650 Super got 41.2 FPS average, while this 5500 XT got 36 FPS average, worthy of a console experience, but not really cutting it on the PC, at least with these settings. This makes it 13% slower than the 1650 Super at 1440p. In Borderlands 3, an AMD-sponsored title, the 1650 Super got 61.1 FPS average, with the 5500 XT performing basically the same at 59.5 FPS average. So the 5500 XT is 3% slower than the 1650 Super, but obviously this isn't something you'd notice. At 1440p, we see similar margins between the two GPUs, with the 1650 Super getting 41.7 FPS average and the 5500 XT getting 40, meaning that again it's only 3% slower, which I'd say is a tie. And the last game we're looking at is The Outer Worlds. At 1080p, the 5500 XT finishes strong at 62.7 FPS average, but the 1560 Super pretty much matches it at 60 FPS. The 5500 XT is technically 4% faster, but really it's basically a tie again. At 1440p, however, surprisingly, the 1650 Super does get a small lead, getting 47.8 FPS average, while the 5500 XT got 43.3 FPS average, meaning it's 9% slower at 1440p in this title, which is a bit unexpected given the larger frame buffer. So as you can see from these results, the 5500 XT wins in some games by a decent margin and loses in others by a small margin, but overall it's hard to tell these GPUs apart. Based on data from older titles not shown here, the 5500 XT is marginally faster than the 1650 Super on average by about 3 or 4%, but nothing earth-shattering, and the The same is true for the RX580 8GB, which lags only a few percentage points behind the 5500 XT on average. I didn't have time to overclock the 5500 XT in time for this review, but I'll post some more results, including more games, over on Cortex.tech in the next few days if you are interested. As far as thermals are concerned, the GPU never exceeded 56 degrees Celsius in a stress test, with the fan spinning at a maximum of 1387 RPM, which meant the power color Red Dragon stays whisper quiet even under full load. The GPU drew a maximum of 132 watts, as spec'd by AMD, which, like I said earlier, is considerably high compared to the 1650 Super, which is on 12 nanometers, performs about the same, but only draws 100 watts. AMD's GPU architectures are improving, but still have a long way to go to match NVIDIA's efficiency levels. So the RX 5500 XT is in a bit of a strange position right now. I cannot recommend the 1650 Super or the 5500 XT 4GB variants. Honestly, buying a 4GB GPU in 2019 is like buying a dual-core CPU. It makes no sense to me that there are 4GB GPUs on the market when the RX 580 from years back comes with 8GB of VRAM. So in my opinion, you should avoid both the 1650 Super and RX 5500 XT 4GB models. As for the 8GB variant, I think it can make sense if you want to upgrade to 1440p and you play either PUBG or Fortnite a lot, which are two of the most popular games out there, to be fair. The 5500 XT is not going to play Red Dead Redemption 2 at 1440p all that smoothly, but in games where it struggles at that resolution, you can always use scaling plus Radeon image sharpening to get a very decent upscaled experience without compromising too much on image quality. The 5500 XT also comes bundled with Monster Hunter Iceborne, and it includes 3 months of Xbox Game Pass. I asked on Twitter how many people actually have ever decided between two competing GPUs because of the games included, and it seems the vast majority of people really only care about the hardware when making a purchasing decision. Still, free games is a nice bonus. AMD has also updated Radeon software with the Adrenaline 2020 update. It looks really nice and has lots of great features like integer scaling, which is also available on Turing GPUs, AMD Link to play your PC games remotely on your phone, and the new Radeon Boost. From my testing, Boost is kind of horrendous on regular LCD panels, but it works pretty well on CRTs and OLED screens, much to my surprise. Again, check Cortex.tech in the next few days as I'll be testing all of these new features more extensively. It's nice to see AMD investing so much in software features, and I feel like Nvidia have been really lazy in this area. The GeForce Experience should be renamed to GeForce Terrible Experience, which begins with the fact that you need to log in with an email and password just to use it, not to mention having to endure the clunky and confusing interface. That alone is enough for me to recommend you avoid Nvidia GPUs altogether, and this is coming from someone who uses a 1080 Ti as my main GPU. So to conclude, avoid the RX 5500 4GB variants, or any GPU with 4GB of VRAM. As for the 8GB version tested today, the RX 5500 XT does what it says on the box. It does 1080p fantastically well, but in my opinion, it's not worth the extra $40 or $50 over the RX 580 8GB. All the way back in August, I asked on Twitter how much you guys would pay for a 128-bit GPU in 2019. And the majority of you said $150, and I agree with you guys. I think $150 should be the price of the 8GB RX 5500 XT. At $200 is too expensive to be worth it. Just get an RX 580 instead while they are still around. And like I said earlier in the video, I do find it interesting that we're getting this level of performance from such a small die. The 5500 XT is a sign of things to come, and soon a 1080p discrete GPU will probably have no place in the market, if it even does today. This video was made possible by my awesome patrons who get exclusive access to the Cortex Discord server where you can talk to me directly and join a family of like-minded and welcoming enthusiasts. Consider supporting my work for just $1 per month. Join my Patreon today. Thanks for watching, and until the next one.